Hello students, we'll start with our 7th unit and talk about front office accounting. So in this chapter, we'll discuss about all the accounts procedures that happen throughout the guest arrival, from pre-arrival to like the proper stay of the guest, and then after the guest departure, whatever the process includes and what are all these processes, we are briefly going to talk about that. I've also prepared a chart for all of you. If you can kindly go through, we are going to talk about front office accounting cycle. This is the stages of a guest stay. Okay, one we have on arrival and pre-arrival. Then we have the duration of stay, on departure and after departure. These are the four stages of a guest cycle. Now, what all accounts and how, what are the different factors that accounts takes care of? See, we are assigning rates and tariff. Accounts definitely plays a major role on that. There is a checking on modes and methods of payments. Then we have establishing credit limit, which is a limit till which the house is given an authority or a guest is given an authority, beyond which he cannot, like take his payment and keep it pending. Then we have posting of charges, how charges are posted into guest accounts. Then we have monitoring credit control. There are methods to which we can control credit. Maintenance of account, that's very important and basically summarizes this front office accounting. We also have settlement of guest folios, important and very much needed in hotels. Settlement of accounts, again very important. Then we have settlement of master folios by company, city ledger and all of that thing, guest ledgers, all of the thing is very important. We also have follow up on bad dates and late charges. So this is a brief of what are we gonna study. Kindly take a look. Pause, go ahead. So we'll start with the definition of accounting. So let us understand what accounting means. It is a systematic process of identifying, recording, measuring, classifying, verifying, summarizing, interpreting, and communicating financial information. It reveals the profit or the losses of a given period and the value of nature of a firm's asset, liabilities, and owner's equity. Now that we have understood the definition, let us understand there might be certain purpose. So the purpose of accounting is that it provides information to the company about the following: resources, which can be money, capital, or manpower, which is available to a firm. Also, the means employed to finance those resources and the results achieved through their usage. So that was about your basic meaning and definition about accounts and its purpose. Now that we are talking about hotels in specific, let us understand how and what accounts team or the accounts main role is. So the first main role is that it produces an accurate set of month to end accounts. It also compares profit to previous periods and forecasts. It does an estimation. It prepares financial budgets and business plans, financial statements and balance sheet production. We'll also get to know about the cash flow statements and payroll control. So students, with this we finish Unit 7, Section 1. So we have two major departments who basically take care of the accounts. One who is in charge of the receivables and one who manages the whole of it.
The front office team, handles cash, and of course accounts is needed there as well. You need to have a prior, understanding of accounts. You need to have a proper understanding of the cash flows and how much, cash at hand do you have in with yourself for running a particular department smoothly. Then after all of the process is done, with each and every shift, the person, drops the checks to the main accounts team. They are now in charge of, communicating, interpreting, summarizing and distributing every things related to accounts. So they also take care of the profit and losses for maybe the week, maybe the particular day, maybe the tenure for a year, maybe 5 years, and they basically check on and make an understanding of the firm or the organization's what is their liabilities and what is their equity, and if the sale is happening pretty well, what are the sectors they need to work on. So that is majorly your what the accounts team checks on. So we'll now talk about the two main components of accounts, debit and credit. Let us just take a look on the diagram that I've made for you. Now we have a debit side, we have a credit side. This is called a T account. You see there's a bar and the formation is of a T, okay? On the debit, which is on the left side, we see we are talking about expenses. We are talking about assets. We are also talking about drawings. Debt is something which comes in. Similarly, credit is something that goes out. We are talking about liabilities. We are talking about income. We are talking about capital. Kindly make a note of this T account. Students, also make a note that this is a factor, both of them has to be balanced, which is why they're on a scale. So once debit, sometimes when the debit goes up, credit will definitely go down, and when the credit goes up, debit will again go down. With this figure, this symbolizes a lot of things. This symbolizes that to reach a perfect level of balance, everything has to be maintained very minutely, very properly. And this is a very interesting thing. This is like maths. So with this, once we get the perfect formula, once we get the code of how to get it done perfectly, we are able to run any organization smoothly. When we know that, with proper regular methods, when we understand that, okay, this is the point wherein I need to fix my, drawbacks. There are certain drawbacks, I need to fix them. With this, you will be able to attain stability. So, accounts or handling cash or maintaining folios, maintaining ledgers, maintaining balances. It's very minute and requires a lot of patience and lot of, creditability. And so let us learn this chapter very minutely. And I hope you're taking all of these diagrams down too.
We'll start with our Unit 7, Section 3. Prior to this video, we have understood accounting definition, the meaning and its purposes. We'll now study about front office accounting and what happens in the hotel. It is basically the creation and maintenance of a guest or a non-guest account, which is done in a timely manner and in accurately. We also keep a track of all the financial transactions for maybe throughout the day, the buying and paying of the customers. Okay, the next point states that it monitors the credit limit of guests. It also helps in preparing a high balance account report, providing an efficient management information system, which is MIS, also maintains effective control over all the cash flow and credit transactions. Now that we know the purpose, we'll have to understand how many types of accounts are there. So, there are two major types of accounts. One is a guest account and the other is a non-guest account.
Now we'll talk about certain privileges and house limit that a guest is offered. The first topic is house limit. Now with a house limit, every guest, suppose on arrival, the guest says that you can, you know, I'll make the payments at the end of my stay. So definitely the, you know, if his charges for the services that he has taken up reaches maybe a limit of 1 lakh, that cannot happen, right? So for every day, if he's not comfortable paying the whole of his, you know, charges at the, prior his stay or before his stay ends, what we can do is we can create a limit, and that is, you know, fixed by the front office manager depending on a lot of factors. But, just to make sure that the guest, what if he's a skipper, what if, what if something goes wrong and he runs away or anything like that, we are trying to keep a house limit. It's called a house limit. So, for example, every day, maybe we and the like the front office receptionist and the guest have created a pact wherein he has to pay 50,000 amount for every day. And then, 50,000 amount if he pays each and every day, we are keeping a track of what his services are like, the nature of his services, how much can he go on and extend. So it's very easier for us to make a note also at the end. It doesn't, like, you know, nothing misses out on us. So it is a maximum credit or purchase limit that is provided to the guest. Okay, now when we see that, also known as a factor, that when a guest reaches, you know, maybe the amount fixed for a particular guest is 50,000, and when he is about 49,000 or 48 or 45,000, he reaches a point where it's called a high balance account, wherein we will make guest calls, or we'll drop in letters wherein we'll request the guest to make payments, so that he doesn't reach a high balance account. He doesn't fall into that category. Now, also to keep in mind that these factors are not majorly given to guests who come in as walk-ins or who have scanty baggages. Scanty baggages meaning maybe one and or a very small luggage with them. So, this is a high risk factor, and we have to handle it very strategically. Also, no credit facility is given to them. Everything is on a direct payment, and also no modes of payment is taken as a guarantee. For example, any debit or credit card, usually that doesn't happen. We usually take APC, all payments in cash.
This is your Unit 7, Section 4. So we'll now talk about a guest account. A guest account is the record of financial transactions between a resident guest and the hotel. So resident guest meaning whoever is staying with us, whoever is staying with the hotel. The front office creates an individual folio, or it is called an account, for each guest. Okay. And on the basis of each guest folio, a final bill is prepared for the guest and presented to the guest at the time of maybe checkout or when he is asking for the bill. We'll now talk about non-guest accounts. So non-guest accounts meaning non-resident guest. They will also have a separate account for them. So a non-guest account is the record of the financial transaction that takes place between a non-resident guest and the hotel. This is also known as a city account. Okay, A non-resident guest, you can use services like the restaurant, the bar, the salon, the health club facilities, or the spa. So they will also need to have a information about the same. So to make everything easier, we have created a non-guest account. So whenever a non-resident guest uses any services of the hotel, we can, you know, move all the information to the same account, the non-resident or the non-guest account. Now that we have understood about the two types of accounts, resident guest accounts and non-resident guest accounts, we also need to understand the various type of charges that can be posted. So transaction is equal to the guest charges. Now guest charges, which can be credit, purchase, can include. What all can they include? One is the room charge, that is credited. The other is the taxes. The next one is the telephone charge. Then we have, if the guest opts for food and beverage, that is included too. And charges for other product or services. So if he's going for the usage of the health spa or the salon, whatever he is, you know, interested in, he'll be required to pay for the same. So these are the transaction that the guest uses, and these are the charges that is posted. Now there are certain principles which is followed throughout the world. One such is generally accepted accounting principle, which is known as GAAPS. Now let us understand what is that. It's the standard and procedures that are maintained or adapted by those responsible for preparing business financial statements for the purpose of ensuring standards and uniformity. So with this, we finish our unit 4, which talks about the types of accounts, the principle, the transactions that goes on. We'll move on to our 5th section. This is Unit 7, Section 5. Now understand, there are certain accounting, when we are learning accounting types and system, there are certain terms which is very much required for you to understand. Such terms are assets, liabilities, equity. We'll first talk about these three. So an asset is an item owned by a business, including cash on hand, whatever money that you have in hand, money in checking or other accounts, money owed to the business, inventories, property, equipment, and furnishings. So all of this that you own is called an asset. Liabilities are debts owed by your business. So if you've paid 50 rupees, that was short, you're paying that for me to help. At the end of today, maybe I am supposed to pay you back the 50 rupees. So that is a debt that I owe to you. Now we'll talk about owner's equity. Equity is assets minus liabilities. So let me just explain you on this. So suppose I have a land, 50 acres of land, and as a liability, I have, taken a loan, and to repay my loan, I have to sell off certain, out of 50 acres of land, I have to sell off 20 acres. Now, whatever I have remain is my equity. Okay. Now we'll move on to the next part. We'll now talk about a uniform system of accounts which is used for lodging industry, which is termed as USALI. What is it? It is a set of standard accounting procedures used to record a hotel's financial transactions and condition. So students, with this we finish section 5 of unit 7. Section 6 of unit 7 we'll talk about accounting, accounts, folio, etc. So students, we'll start with our section 7, unit 7. Now that we have understood accounting as a subject, let us understand there are other accounting terms which you'll be needing. So the first one is accounts receivable. Okay, that's the short form is AR. It is the money owed to a hotel. Example, the money that we can get or receive from guests. Accounts payable. Similarly, the money which the hotel owes, example, to the suppliers, vendors, or any account that is the hotel has taken loan from. Okay. Also, there are retained earnings. Now, profit earned but not paid. Disbursed, okay, to the business owners. Whatever money that we have gained profit from, whatever money we have gained as a profit that has not been distributed, that is your retained earnings. We'll now take up double entry accounting. Just understand all of these are the terms which is majorly used in accounts, okay? Just for you guys to have an idea about, I am explaining. Most of this, if you just get an idea about, get to know what it means, that should be good enough. You do not need to understand it in depth or in details, okay? But definitely you need to understand what it means. So we'll talk about double entry accounting. It is a system of recording financial transactions in a way that maintains entry of one transaction in two books, once on the credit side and the other is on the debit side. So it is a double entry process. Now this double entry accounting helps us in preparing what? It helps us in preparing the trial balance. Okay. Now you already know what the term debit and credit means. So debit, an accounting transaction that records a change on the left hand side of the T account. In the previous video, we had talked about the T account, right? Now, credit in accounting transaction is one that records the change on the right-hand side of the T account. Now, we'll talk about a very important topic, which is vouchers. Now, it's very important for the front office team members, majorly the cashier. So, let us understand what it is about. The front desk cashier is required to present supporting documents as a proof for all the financial transactions, buying or paying, okay, that is recorded in the guest folios. Okay, every guest has his or her folio. Now, voucher is a written instrument that serves to confirm or witness for a transaction that has taken place. We need proofs, right? So this is an example. This is a documentation. Commonly, a voucher is a document that shows goods have been brought or services have been given, authorizes payment, and indicates the ledger accounts in which these transactions will be recorded. So everything is kept in where? It is kept in the ledger account, wherein we can get each and every transaction as and when it has been recorded. With this, we finish vouchers as a main topic. We'll talk about vouchers in details in the next chapter. This is the end of section 7, unit 7. We'll move on to section 8. I'll also give you an example of how many types of vouchers are there. So first, you see, we have the debit or credit side, and majorly it's differentiated with so. First, we have a visitor's paid out voucher.
Then we have a cash receipt voucher, a travel agent voucher, a guest allowance voucher. On the credit side, we'll have miscellaneous or charge voucher, a telephone call voucher, a commission voucher, and a restaurant or a bar check voucher. With the next section, I'll be discussing in details about all of these types of voucher. Kindly make a note of this in your front office journal.
In section 9, we'll talk about visitors paid out voucher. Okay, we'll talk about in details about this. So what is it? It is a cash paid out by the hotel, okay, on behalf of a guest for petty payments like a taxi fare, cinema tickets, maybe medicine, maybe postage, or anything that the guest asks the front office to pay on behalf of him. So suppose me being a guest, I took a taxi from maybe the nearest metro station to reach the hotel, or nearest airport to reach the hotel. I'm coming to the hotel for the first time. Now I am not carrying, you know, smaller notes. I only have 2000, I only have 500. Now maybe the amount is, say, about 105 rupees. I do not have 105 rupees cash. What I can do is, I can come to the main porch and just ask the security team, or just reach out to the front desk that if you can help me with this, just pay as of now for me. The charges are 105 rupees. What they'll do is, they'll tell me, certainly ma'am, kindly just sign in this paid out voucher. It's a proof, it's a statement wherein it states that the hotel is paying on behalf of you the amount, the said amount, for example, if it's 105 or whatever the amount is, and then the said date, the said time, and we can pay on to the taxi driver. Like this, at the time of checkout, if I say there was no 105 rupees, paid out from your side, what we can do is, in case there's a clarification error, in case it can happen that the guest has forgotten, okay? It can happen that there's a glitch. Just to keep a proof, we'll have the voucher handy with us. We'll have the voucher in his folio, wherein if he claims that, I'm sorry, I didn't pay this, or if there's any confusion, we definitely have a statement, we definitely have a paper to fall back on. Okay, so that's your visitors paid out voucher. We'll now talk about miscellaneous charges. Okay, now what are miscellaneous charge vouchers? Guest miscellaneous charges may include the following. For example, if the guest has taken shoe shine, if the guest has taken the health club facility, the barber shop, maybe the beauty parlor or the salon services, pastry shop, postal charges. So these are your miscellaneous charges. We'll start with Unit 7, Section 6. We'll talk about cash banks. So let us understand what cash banks are. A cash bank is an amount of cash given to a cashier before the shift begins. What does it do? It helps in order to tender exact change in every transaction. He or she is the only person who signs for it and has the access to it. Also, the person is responsible for that at the end of the shift. The cash bank amount is an important, and it is separated. And the remaining cash is put in an envelope and deposited with the chief cashier. Okay, so every associate after the end of their shift will, you know, check whatever cash they have in bank. That has to remain the same. And whatever collection that they have made, whatever deposit that they have done, everything has to come with proofs and attached and kept at the envelope and deposited with the chief cashier. Here, the chief cashier will check each day if everything is correct. Now, suppose there's a shortage or there's too much cash flow. What do we do in case of that? Let's see what can be done. Now, definitely, we know that monetary differences can happen. Now, when differences between the money placed in front of his cash envelope and the cashier's net cash receipt, that is whatever we have, covered for the day, if there's a difference between that and the cashier notices that there is an overage, which is more, or shortages, that is due back. Net cash receipt is the amount of cash, checks, and other negotiable instruments in the cashier's drawer, minus the initial cash bank, plus the paid outs. So this is very important. The cashier's job is very important. He or she has to minutely check before taking handovers from the previous shift. Everything has to be noted so that in case there's a shortage and overage, we have something to fall back upon. We have something to say. This doesn't come in a day or two. With years and years of practice, somebody is able to become a proper cashier. And with practice, he'll be able to, if there's any mishaps, we'll definitely have the front office team manager, we have the duty manager to help us with the same. But we'll definitely try to avoid that. When they have given us the responsibility, it is our duty to make everything, go seamlessly. So we should avoid shortage or overage at any point of time. So now, in case of a due back, what will happen? Occurs when the cashier pays out more than the amount received as cash bank, and that there is not enough cash in the drawer to restore in the initial bank. Due backs are also known as due bank. When VPO is settled later, due back money is recovered and returned. When, like the monthly end, when everything is settled, what happens is we'll definitely have a cash, more cash at the cashier, main cashier, because there's a lot of miscommunication, there's a lot of, fallbacks in our main cash. So we'll definitely have more cash at our main cashier. So what he'll do is he'll return back us the money that was falling short. We'll talk about cash receipt voucher. It is a written document that is produced by a company each time it receives money for goods or services. Okay? Guess nothing very difficult, very simple. It's one kind of a voucher. So every time that a transaction takes place, transactions meaning only when we are receiving. So that time maybe it is for any services or goods, it is produced. Now we have a telephone call voucher. Exactly so. In automated hotel, calls from room are directly billed into the account. If a call is made through operator, then a bill is raised on the telephone. We also have travel agents voucher, a voucher detailing the accommodation, transportation, food, and entertainment to be provided to the bearer, the guest. And once the transaction has been done, the payment may be direct by the guest or sent to the agent, whatever the guest has settled for. If he says that the extras, which is food, and maybe if he's taken any services or alcohol, anything that he's consumed will be paid by him. That is direct is extras, and room accommodation is the part of travel agent. So that's sent directly to the travel agent.
Now, a commission voucher, as you can clearly understand, it is for travel agent, tour operators, maybe taxi drivers, whoever provides business to the hotel, they get a commission. Say, for example, the hotel has a policy of providing 10% commission. So they'll definitely, install this. They have this voucher. They would request for the guests for signatures, and through accounts, everything is then distributed. We then have guest allowances. This you'll majorly find in hotels, this is an everyday scenario. So if there's a problem, there's a glitch, or maybe there's a, poor service, a rebate or deduction is done from an invoice bill to give a compensation to the guest. Very simple, but very important. And you can see this, you can point this very often. The last one is a restaurant or a bar check. When the restaurant and a bar check will have the details of the charges of the food, drinks, anything that has been ordered by the guest. When the check is presented, the guest will do confirmation and sign for the same. Now that we are talking about vouchers, I'll show you with an example of a petty cash voucher. See, that's an example of your petty cash voucher. It's just a demo one, so just make a note. First, we definitely will have the date, the particular day when we are using this, and we'll chalk out the vendor's name. We'll write the vendor's name. Then we have description of items purchased, the amount. Then we'll calculate the total and fill in this box. We'll also write the account name. We'll check the name of the account, as in if there's an account name which is created, say for example 900007, so like that we'll write in the account number. We'll also write who has approved the same. Whatever, if the amount that is given is correct, who has signed, who is the authority. Then we write the signature of the purchaser. Department has to approve too, right? So the department head would sign. And this has to be stamped with the hotel or organization's official stamp. And this will go on with the original receipt. This will be attached at the back of the voucher. Okay?